probably the most popular records we did were like Elvis and Neil Diamond.
B.J. Thomas.
B.J., yeah, some of those records.
B.J. Thomas.
Yeah. I can't stop this feeling deep inside of me. Girl, you just don't realize what you do to me.
The Box Tops.
As I look back on a love so sweet,
The Letter. We had two violins and a viola, and I was scared to death. So I was up there conducting the two violins and a viola on the Letter.
It had the horn.
Had the two trombones.
Give me a ticket for an aeroplane. Ain't got time to take a fast train.
I remember sitting out in the studio playing the parts on the organ. And till Dan liked what he heard. And he said, do you have any ideas for anything else? And I said, well, what about trombones doing this? And I started playing that little trombone lick, and he liked it.
That's cool. Whose idea was the jet plane?
That was Dan's.
My baby used to rip me a leather.
Chip tried forever to talk him out.
Talking
about
it, that's right.
He did everything in the world to get him to take that jet off the end of it, but he wouldn't.
He said the jet needs to go, and Dan says, no, the jet's got to stay.
Chip said, turn it down. Dan, turn it up.
When she wrote me a letter, said she couldn't live without me no more.
Dusty Springfield's son of Preacher Man's recognized just about by everybody.
Yeah.
The only boy who could ever teach me.
When Dusty walked in, Dusty Springfield walked in at studio, she looked around and it was a old studio, was just funky, dirty, funky old place. Great place to cut records, but it just didn't look like the slick studio. She fell in on our little scene. From the first day she walked in, I thought she was going to leave. And then when we got through at the end of the week, she cried because she was so pleased with the way everything had come about. And that Dusty in Memphis album, man, what a great album. And it still sounds good.
Billy Ray was a preacher's son, and when his daddy would visit, he'd come along. When they gathered around and started talking, that's when Billy would take me walking. Out through the backyard, we go walking. Then he'd look into my eyes. Lord knows to my surprise, the only one who could ever reach me was the son of a preacher man. The only boy who could ever teach me was the son of a preacher man. Yes, he was. He was.
The Dock of the Bay saved our lives.
Sit on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. Sitting on the dock of the bay.
We were supposed to have gone on the road with Otis Redding in his Beechcraft DH-10 that Saturday. And Jim Stewart came to us and said, boys, you won't be going on this trip. You have to stay and put horns on Dock of the Bay. And that Saturday night, Andrew called me and said,
they're gone. Otis' plane crashed.
Look like nothing's gonna change. Everything still remains the same.
The first time Elvis came in, we had a problem with rats in that funky studio, and the exterminators had come in. We'd even had to stop sessions sometimes because rats were fighting up on the ceiling. We'd have to stop for them. And Elvis's first entrance into the back door, big old rat fell right down in front of him, and he liked it went ballistic.
When he walked in, everybody kind of backed up a step.
Wow,
that's Elvis Presley. It shocked me that it affected me.
When we got down to working just us and Elvis for 2 weeks, and that's where when we started cutting hits.
I'm still trying to weasel my way into the group, and I was trying to find something to play. And you remember there was in the little room next to the studio, there was a timpani. Mm-hmm. And I went in there, took a microphone, pointed it down on the timpani, ran in the control room, plugged it in, turned the fader up, went back in there, and they said, okay, we're rolling. That's, I played tape. I had to mic myself and plug myself in. But I got on the damn record.
Reg, what about Memphis Soul Stew by King Curtis? Remember how that started?
What's the name of that place next door?
Ranch House.
We was all over there with King Curtis, and he picked up the menu, and they always had a daily special. And he just started ad-libbing, and he said, oh, today's special is Memphis Soul Stew. And he went down the whole list of, give me an order of fat back drums, pizza red hot guitar.
We're going to tell you right now.
What was the organ one?
Pinch
of organ, right, yeah.
Half a teacup of bass.
Half a teacup of bass. Anyway, we finished our lunch.
Now I need a pound
went next door,
of fat back
bang,
drums.
Cut the record.
When we did Sweet Caroline, we had worked all day on I Ain't No Hippie, Just a New York Boy. And Neil was packing his guitar up. Tommy came out. He said, well, wait, don't you have anything else? He said, well, I've got one I've started on, but I haven't finished it yet. And Tommy said, well, let's hear it. And he got his guitar back out and started playing Sweet Caroline. We all kind of joined in, if I remember correctly. And that was like a one or two take.
That was a piano lick to begin with, and when the record came out, they had taken the piano off, and Great Big Horns was doing.
Your time never seemed so good.
Play off of each other. Mm-hmm. I'd play a lick or a line or something like that. You'd pick up on it, vice versa. And we'd all, with the eye contact, was really important.
Yeah, the eye contact thing.
You don't ever see that anymore. And I miss that a whole lot. You know, it's just like everybody's got their own part now. They get their part perfect. And doesn't matter what this guy's doing, as long as his is right, you know.
Private rooms almost now for isolation. They're trying to get everything so clean that we get separated to the point you can't communicate with anybody.
Like we're all sitting around playing. And, you know, I'll be sitting here if I look up and maybe have eye contact, you know.
If we looked at each other and you jumped on a lick I was doing or I jumped on a lick you were doing or anybody, we consider that a compliment because you like the lick well enough to play it along with me. These days, if you jump on somebody else's lick, they're almost insulted. They don't want you to play that. That's my lick. You stay out of my way.
Some gotta win, some gotta lose. Good damn Charlie's got the blues.
Just call me Angel of the Morning, Angel, then slowly turn away.
We basically arrange the songs on the floor, is what we do now. I don't know if we consider ourselves duly compensated for doing something like that or not. I don't know.
The artist gets royalties, the writer gets royalties, publisher gets royalties, producer gets royalties, and musicians basically just make whatever scale is.
Okay, so what do they do when they recut something that we've played on that's got all this sweat we've poured into it? And they copy every lick that you've played, and blah blah blah, and do a record of that. That's out and out thievery.
We've made the same money off of, like say, Driftway that we made off of Tex Nobody that we worked for a few months ago. You know, the point has been brought up that musicians should get a piece of the action when a record sells, having had a lot to do with the arrangement.
On the big records, where somebody brings in licks and that, what's the old saying, play me a great lick, it'll make my record a hit. When you do that, maybe you should get a point or something on there. The band should split some royalties.
If there ever was a hit lick played on a record, it was the intro that Reggie played on Drift Away. Not saying that what I did wasn't important also, but if anybody deserved a point on a record, I think that you having come up with it out of your own head is without anybody telling you what to play, it's your idea and everything. I think that was a huge contributor to that being his record. So if anybody deserved a point on a record, I think you did.
If I had gotten hired to read that part, there'd have been somebody else playing it because I can't read. I get hired to play what I do. I'm, as a reading musician, I wouldn't be working at all.
Shall I just come in when it feels good?
The dreams die, love still lives. It shows how strong we are. You hold me close.
I'd love to hear that instrument. Yeah, please.
Starts at half.
Some pretty unique licks in all of these songs that we cut in Memphis, and it would have been nice to have gotten points off of the ones that we had that, you know, that were big hits back then, because scale at one point was low, and we put in a lot of time and a lot of effort just to cut maybe one song. We were running long sessions for many hours, like for one session. So I think we deserve a lot more than what we made for the material that we've cut.